Thank you, Ali and worship team. What a great morning we've had celebrating together. Well, how many of you have at least one family pet at home right now? How many have had a family pet in the past? Well, like many families, I presume, our family has gone through a series of family pet phases, especially when our boys were younger. For example, we went through a lizard phase of family pets. We have four boys, so we had two lizards. They were named Kobe and Shaq. They lived in a little glass room in one of the boys' rooms. And they were great. They actually ate live crickets, which was really kind of fun. It was great until we went on vacation and came home and realized we had left the little heat lamp on. Yeah, crispy critters. And then we moved on to the hamster phase. And the hamster phase went until one of our hamsters developed a very serious psychiatric issue. And we moved out of the hamster phase. We eventually graduated to a dog phase. And we had our beloved Labrador Retriever for about 10 years. Her name was Mocha. She died about 5 years ago, and we still miss her. But it all began with a fish phase. Any of you go through the fish phase of pets? By the way, last service, somebody noticed that I did not mention a cat phase. That's true. I'm going to say nothing more about that, because every time I talk about cats, cat people get all upset. One time I talked about cats, the next day in my office, there were like 9 cats walking around loose because somebody let them off. So, I'm not saying, we did not have a cat phase, but I do love cats. Okay, went to the fish phase. We started the fish phase when one of our boys came home from Adventure Club, which is a program here at church on Wednesday nights for elementary school children, and he had a guppy in a styrofoam cup with water. What they were doing, I have no idea, but he came home from church with a guppy. We put it into a Cool Whip container, expected it to expire during the night. It didn't. That guppy lived for like 2 weeks. We called it Spartacus because it was a survivor. But that got us into the fish phase. We eventually graduated up to goldfish. We had a whole series of goldfish. And we had a series of goldfish because we had longevity problems with our goldfish. I'd come home with a goldfish, the boys would name it, we'd put it in a little tank, and it would be there for a few days, and then one of the boys would find it floating on the surface. You know, not good. We'd have a somber burial at sea, if you know what I mean. And then I'd go looking for another goldfish. Finally, I decided the problem was quality of fish. So I went to the pet store and I upgraded. I got a more expensive goldfish. It cost 3 times what the other goldfish cost. And it came with a very interesting guarantee. They said if anything happened to that goldfish within 2 weeks, I could bring the expired fish back and they would replace it, no charge. There you go, replacement goldfish guarantee. So that's the fish we got. And I actually did the replacement thing one time, put it in a little baggie, took it back in. And then I decided I wasn't going to do that anymore. First of all, because I didn't think it was very fair to the fish. I eventually decided that the problem was ours. We were the problem. Secondly, I didn't know if I wanted to teach my boys that life came with a replacement guarantee. But the truth is, the story that we look at today teaches us exactly that. Let's begin by looking at Mark chapter 16 as we reread the great story that comes to us in the New Testament. Mark writes, "When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him." Now let me pause there, a little sidebar here that you might miss. But this is one of the clearest arguments, most persuasive arguments for the authenticity of the story we're reading today. Because in that day and that time, if you were going to make up a story about a resurrection, you would never, ever put women as the ones who discovered the empty tomb. Never. Because in that culture at that time, a woman's testimony was not worth anything in a court of law. So you would have put men there. But they put women there because this is how the story actually happened. "And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, 'Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?' And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, 'Don't be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you.'" So the great story begins with the question, who will roll away the stone? And I think there are two levels of meaning to this question. First, the most obvious one, the literal meaning, is the physical stone that sealed the ancient tomb of Jesus of Nazareth. Now, this picture on the screen is another tomb dating to about the same time, but it's not the tomb where Jesus was laid, but it's one like it that shows you what one of these stones would have been like. Scholars believe that these burial stones were somewhere between 3,000 and 4,000 pounds in terms of heaviness, and it took several men using levers to move them. So this is the first stone we're talking about. Who will move away the stone so we can anoint his body? But I think there's a second level of meaning here that we might consider today, and that's kind of a spiritual, emotional level of meaning. See, one of my little theories of life is that we all go through life carrying backpacks, kind of like this one. Only the backpacks we carry through life are invisible. You carried one in here with you this morning. Now, some of our backpacks we carry around are smaller and lighter, and you slipped it under a seat in front of you, nobody even notices you carried it in here. But others of them are so large and so heavy, you've been dragging them so long, you almost didn't even make it in here today. See, our backpacks carry burdens like shame or guilt or fear or regret. And we all have them. And I think the Bible actually talks to us about these burdens. In Matthew 11, 28, Jesus says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden," that means who carry heavy burdens, "and I will give you rest." In other words, Jesus is telling us that he came to help answer the question, who will roll away the stone? I want to talk about three stones today. That's what's in my backpack. The first stone we're going to talk about I call the stone of pain. Stone of pain. A lot of years ago, when I was just beginning here as youth pastor at this church, a woman called to make an appointment. She had a daughter that was in our student ministry at the time, so I assumed she wanted to talk about one of the myriad of issues that a parent might typically want to talk about. So she came in, she started to talk. But she didn't just talk about her daughter, she just kept talking. She would go from one subject to the next, kind of like a hummingbird. And I had trouble just getting a word in edgewise. She talked about her work, she talked about her house, talked about her husband, talked about her daughter. And she could really talk. And it was like trying to catch a moving train. And I didn't feel like I was very helpful to her. And I found a way to end the conversation and just felt, that wasn't very helpful. Well, she called back in a couple of weeks. She wanted another appointment. This time I thought, well, maybe I'll just let her talk. I won't try to, you know, interject any thoughts or wisdom or anything. That was a mistake. Because she came in and she talked for 55 minutes straight. I mean, hardly without taking a breath. I didn't say a single word, I just nodded. I thought about faking a seizure or something so I could just get at the end, but I didn't. Ended the conversation and just hoped she didn't call again because I didn't know how to help her. She called back again. She wanted another conversation. Evidently, she was enjoying it. This time, I'd been reading an article about something called pathological talkers. And it suggested that to help them, you have to stop them every time they change the subject and get them to focus on one thing. So I decided I'd get up my energy and my courage and I'd do that. She came in, sure enough, 30 seconds in, she changed the subject. I said, hold on, stop right there. You were just talking about your daughter or whatever. Go back there and tell me more about that. And I had to do that about four or five times in the first few minutes. And all of a sudden, she just dissolved into tears. I mean, sobbing tears. I was shocked because I didn't think I'd done anything. And she started telling me about her twin sister who had died when they were children, and at the funeral, her parents had denied her the ability to cry. They forbid her to cry at her own sister's funeral. And then I understood. This poor woman was carrying in her backpack the stone of pain. All those years of unresolved grief. I understood. We see this in the story that John tells us in John chapter 20. He says, "But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped to look in the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping?'" I put those in red so you can see them. "She said to them, 'I have taken away my Lord. I do not know where they've laid him.' Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?' Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, 'Sir, if you've carried him away, please tell me where you've laid him and I will take him away.' Jesus said to her, 'Mary.' She turned and said to him in Aramaic, 'Rabboni,' which means teacher. Twice in the little story we see, once from the angel, once from Jesus himself, the question, why are you weeping? Every parent who's parented little children understands this question. You ask it 100 times, little one comes running to you, crying, and you scoop them up. Why are you crying? Where does it hurt? Tell mommy, tell daddy. See, Mary is weeping because she's carrying in her backpack some heavy stones. Stone of sadness. She's lost one she loves. The stone of despair. Her hope has been crushed. Her faith in Jesus has been crushed. Maybe the stone of loneliness she's carrying. Fear. These are the stones of pain. And sometimes we put these stones in our backpack ourselves because of things that we do, decisions we make that create pain for ourselves. But sometimes other people put them in our backpack for us. Sometimes even people who say they love us do things and say things that create pain. Sometimes pain just happens. It seems random. Hardly a week goes by when Jeff and I and other pastors don't talk to someone about a stone they're carrying, a job loss, loss of a loved one, an illness, a miscarriage, so many stones and so many backpacks. Maybe you carried some in here with you this morning. If I ask the question today, why are you weeping? I get as many answers as there are people in the room. We all carry these pains with us. And to each one, this story says, Jesus rolls away the stone of our pain. Notice, he follows the question, why are you weeping, with another question. Who are you seeking? Who are you looking for? Who are you hoping will help you with this stone? And then he speaks her name, Mary. And when she hears him say her name, she recognizes him, and her despair, her sadness, becomes joy, like the parent who comforts a child just by their presence, holding on to them until the wailing becomes a cry, and the cry becomes a sniffle, and then they jump down and run off and play again. Jesus says to Mary, I know you. I know your name. I know where it hurts. And if you'll let me, more than that, I can help carry this burden for you. I can take the stone from your backpack, and I can put it in mine. Notice, while Mary's even asking the question, who will roll away the stone had already been moved in front of the tomb. See, Jesus, the Bible says, is the God who took on human flesh. He entered into this broken world and absorbs our pain into himself. He's the one of which the prophet said in Isaiah 53, surely he was born, has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. He's the one who agonized in the Garden of Gethsemane, crying out to his heavenly Father, let this cup pass from me, and sweating great drops of blood as he anticipated his suffering. He is the one who, with nails and hands in his feet, hung on the cross and felt his heavenly Father turn his face away as he took on the sins of the world and cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus' death means he has entered fully into our pain and our suffering. There's no depth of pain to which you can descend that he has not already been to. He knows why you weep today. He knows where it hurts, and he's able to carry the burden and the weight of your pain. But there's a second stone I want to talk about today. And I call this the stone of failure. Stone of failure. When I was in about the third grade, I suddenly started having trouble in one of my school subjects. I no longer remember which one it was. Knowing me, it was probably math, because I probably stopped paying attention and missed something in subtraction or whatever. And I, instead of getting my usual A's and B's, I was getting back these papers that had all kinds of red ink on them, D's and F's. Remember we used to use like letter grades and you knew what they meant? probably reasons why we don't do that anymore. This story is probably one of them. But I was not used to that. And I had to take all my papers home from school because my parents wanted to know how I was doing. And even at 7 or 8 years old, I was embarrassed. I didn't really want to make my failures public, especially not with my mom and dad, so I came up with a plan. In my 7 or 8 year old head, my plan was I would show them all the good papers, but the bad ones, I would just, as soon as I got home, I'd slip them behind the bookcase in my room and they'd be gone forever. Nobody would ever see those papers. And that was my plan. It went perfectly for a couple of weeks. And then one day, as I got home from school, my dad was waiting. And that wasn't all that unusual because he would be there sometimes. So he asked me how school was going. I had a good day. It was fine. How's your subjects going? He mentioned the subject where I've been struggling, and now I'm starting to get a little sweaty. And I said, no, going okay. And then he pulled out the heavy artillery. He said, you've been bringing home all your papers? I thought, what, did the teacher call him? Does he know something? Technically, I have brought them all home. I just hid half of them. So I said, I doubled down. Yeah. And then he said, and then he took out a wad of papers. Turns out my mom cleaned behind that bookcase. Who knew that, right? But that's the stone of failure. I'd lied to my father. That's the stone of shame. We see that stone in this text, Mark 16. We read it already, and he said to them, do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who is crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. And then this, but go tell his disciples and Peter that he's going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. Notice those two little words. Why does the angel feel the need to say, go tell his disciples and Peter? Why does he single out Peter? Peter was one of the disciples. Why does he say both? Well, what do we know about Peter at this time? Just a couple of nights earlier, on the very night that they shared the Passover together, what we call the Last Supper, on that night at that table, Peter had boasted of his own courage. I will never fall away, Lord, not me. I would die for you, he said. And just within a couple hours, out of fear, he denied he even knew Jesus three times. See, Peter was carrying a stone marked failure. Shame. The stone in Peter's heart was heavy. And I would guess there are plenty of backpacks here this morning that have at least one stone in them marked regret or failure or shame. But notice, the stone too has already been moved. Jesus has already wiped away Peter's failure and his sin. Peter just doesn't know it yet. He's hiding in fear and shame. He's clutching his backpack to himself. He won't let go of it. We do that sometimes, don't we? But those two little words, and Peter. In those two little words, Jesus is sending a message to his dear friend, and he's sending the same message to us today. Whoever you are, whatever you've done, however far and however long you've dragged the backpack of shame and regret through your life, however deeply you've tried to hide all that stuff, however heavy those stones are, through his death and resurrection, he has already removed those stones. You are already forgiven. That's the gospel. And then there's a third stone that I want to talk about, and it's the heaviest one. It's the one marked death, the stone of death. When I was 10 years old, the summer I turned 10, two things happened that forever changed the way I see the world. The first was my grandmother passed away at age 58 from breast cancer. This is an old photo of my grandma, Grandma Sloan, holding me when I was a baby, circa 1956. Check out that car in the background. She was my mother's mother. We called her Mom. She and Pop, my grandfather, lived in the hills of eastern Kentucky where my mother grew up. We only saw her once every couple of years. So while I loved her as grandmother, Mom, I didn't feel particularly close to her. So when she died, we all went down to her funeral, this tiny little town in the hills of Kentucky. And I remember being more fascinated with death than saddened. I'd never seen it before, never been to a funeral before. I was fascinated with everything about it. I could watch my mother's grief. I could see her weeping like I'd never seen her weep before. I'd seen her siblings grieve, but I was more fascinated. It didn't touch me as deeply as it touched them. But we got home, and a couple weeks later, something else happened. The second event took place. What I remember is being out in front of our home in New York, my brother, myself, my mom and dad, and our little pet dachshund terrier, Sugar. Had lived with us most of my life at that point. This is my brother, Joe, to the left, Mike, me to the right, and our little dog. She slept most nights in my bed, and we were out in front of our house, and for reasons I no longer remember, it was very unusual, she ran across, which she never did, she ran across the busy street in front of our house. Now, my dad had taught her over the years to respond to his whistle. He had this really unique whistle, which I could never imitate, but whenever he whistled, she'd come running. Sure enough, he whistled for her, because she was across the street. She picked up her head, and she dashed straight back across the street, right into the path of a speeding car. I watched it with my own eyes. She was killed instantly. And that was the first time at age 10, I felt the stone of death. Listen to what Luke tells us in his version of the story, Luke 24. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they, the women once again, went to the tomb taking the spices they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Why do you seek the living among the dead?" What a strange and curious question. I mean, these women knew Jesus was dead. They were there at the foot of the cross. The men had all run away in fear, but the women were there. And they watched him take his last breath. They watched him struggle and bleed and die. They watched the soldiers shove the spear up through his heart, and they watched all the water and blood come out. They saw his lifeless body taken down, and now they were going to anoint his body properly for burial. They knew he was dead, and now they carried in their hearts the stone marked death, heavy, immovable, permanent. And I would guess most of you in the room today know what this stone feels like. And yet, by the very question the angel asks, we know that even then, even at that point, that stone had already been moved. The heaviest one had already been rolled away. Now I want to be as clear as I can. The center of our faith, the reason we're here today, is not the moral and ethical teachings of Jesus. As wonderful as they are, as true as they are, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Love your neighbor. That's not why we're here. The center of our faith is not the great traditions of the church, as comforting as worship can be when we're together. The center of our faith is death and resurrection. The astonishing, and some would say outrageous, claim that Jesus of Nazareth, a real man who lived in real time and was really put to death on a Roman cross, was dead and buried and sealed in an ancient tomb, that same man rose again to life 3 days later. Now, I know that most people in our culture regard the resurrection story as kind of religious mythology, that it's a quaint story that we get out once a year to help us feel better and to give us a reason to buy new clothes and eat chocolate bunnies. I know that's what our culture thinks. Maybe you even came in this morning, and that's pretty much, if you're honest, how you tended to think about it. Here's how I know that. If people understood and believed that the death of Christ is as verifiable a historical event as, let's say, the assassination of JFK, if we knew and really understood and believed that the resurrection of Christ is a real, historical, verifiable event, then we would know it's also the watershed of all human history. And we would know that it's the source of hope upon which the eternal destiny of every human soul depends. And our churches would be overrun. Week after week, they'd be just overrun. But they aren't. I saw a study this week that said only 41% of Americans planned on being in church this weekend. 41%. And out of those, half will not come back next week. Explain it the way any way you like, and many do. Nonsensical theories like the body was stolen. That was debunked over 100 years ago by people who don't even believe the New Testament. Or maybe they went to the wrong tomb. That's like forgetting where Lincoln is buried. Or maybe the disciples hallucinated. Really? 500 at a time? Or Jesus only fainted on the cross. And then miraculously, without medical help, recovered from a wound to his heart and a punctured lung and blood loss, and without food or water, managed to have the strength to push aside a 3,000-pound stone and walk out into history. You can explain it the way any way you want. You can ignore it at your own peril, because it not only is the resurrection of Christ that which makes sense of the whole Bible story, that which makes sense of all of human history, it's also that which makes sense of your story. Because here's the truth. The resurrection of Christ from the dead is the only hope any of us have for dealing with this stone marked death. It's the only hope. In 1 Corinthians, Paul himself says, "If Christ is not raised, your faith is in vain and you're still in your sins." In other words, without this story being true, the whole Bible is not worth the paper it's printed on. You're wasting your time. Peter said, remember Peter? That same guy, before he died, he wrote, He's caused us to be born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now think about it. If this story didn't happen exactly the way it comes to us in the pages of the New Testament, we wouldn't be here today, because this church would not be here today. There'd be a Walmart here, or a movie theater, or a bowling alley. This church wouldn't be here. There's no way to explain the church and the influence of Jesus over the last 2,000 years apart from resurrection. The New Testament tells us, eyewitnesses tell us, history itself tells us he is risen, and because he is risen, the stone marked death has been rolled away. Just before 6 a.m. on the morning of Sunday, October 17th, 2009, my phone rang. I was up early preparing for church that day. I looked down and saw my brother's name on the screen, and my heart started to race a little bit, because you get a phone call from a family member that early, a lot of times it's not good news. And it wasn't. When I picked up the phone, he said the words that I had long thought about but never wanted to hear. What he said was, "Dad's had a massive stroke. Looks like we're going to lose him." And he told me a few other details, what had happened, how my father had collapsed in the night, stopped breathing in the ambulance, and how the doctor had just met with he and my mom and said, "Your dad has zero hope of meaningful recovery. The bleed is so great, zero hope," he said. Now, my brother and I knew very well what our father's wishes were. He had been quite clear with us on a number of occasions. "No, don't do anything special for me," he said, he'd say. He was ready to go, prepared. And so we talked. If that was the news, we'd let him go. No special measures. I hung up, called my wife who was out of town, called my son who was in college, and jumped in the shower and started formulating in my mind what I would say at my own father's memorial service. Now, some of you know the rest of the story. Within minutes, my brother called back, said a second neurosurgeon looked at the images and believed the condition was reversible, that the bleed was in a certain place they could get to it. To make a long story short, with great fear and trepidation, we authorized the procedure. They drilled a hole in my father's head, released the pressure. 24 hours later, he woke up from a coma. Today, he's worshiping at my brother's church, and he brags incessantly about being able to shoot his age in golf. Now, the important part of that story I want you to hear is not that my dad recovered. Don't get me wrong, that's great. We'd love having him around. And he listens to these sermons sometimes. "Dad, I want you to know, we're glad you're here." But that's not the most important thing, and he would agree. Here's why. My dad's going to die someday. He is. He's 83. Eventually, he's going to die, just like my brother John died in 1988 in a traffic accident. Just as I will one day, just as you will too. Human death rate hovering right about 100%. The most important part of the story is that when we thought his earthly life was over, that doctor said, "No chance." We were good. We were sad. Had we lost him that day, we'd still be grieving in our way, but we'd be good. We'd be good because Jesus had long since rolled away a stone of death in my dad's life. He knew he was absolutely prepared. We knew he was absolutely unafraid. We knew he was absolutely certain of the promise of the resurrection. So we were good. So how about you? Are you good with that stone? You can be, because 2,000 years ago, the stone that sealed an ancient tomb was rolled away, because 2,000 years ago, Jesus of Nazareth walked out of that tomb and into history and into his church and into the heart of every person who would open their heart to believe in him, and into this room this morning by his Spirit, because he still moves stones. Jesus still moves the stones of our pain. He bears them for us. He still moves the stone of our failures and regrets, because he forgives every one of them. And ultimately, he's moved the stone of death itself, because he is risen. Hallelujah, he is risen. Would you bow with me as I close? Lord Jesus, how we thank you for this great story today. It's not just a story we get out to feel better. It's not a cuddly story we get out at bedtime. It's the truth. We celebrate your truth today. We thank you that that ancient stone was rolled away, and that ancient tomb was empty. And that because you are risen, our pains can be comforted. Our failures are forgiven, and even death is not the final word. So may we know by faith once again the great power of your resurrection life. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Thank you, Eric and worship team. Receive now the benediction. May we go now in the name of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who reigns today in his church, who reigns in our hearts, and one day will reign forever in his eternal kingdom. Amen. Have a wonderful, blessed Resurrection Day.